Listening Library presents Encyclopedia Brown and the Case of the Secret Pitch by Donald J. Sobol. Read by Jason Harris.
The Case of the Secret Pitch. Idaville looked like any other town of its size from the outside. On the inside, however, it was different. 10-year-old Encyclopedia Brown, America's Sherlock Holmes in sneakers, lived there. Besides Encyclopedia, Idaville had 3 movie theaters, a little league, 4 banks, and 2 delicatessens. It had large houses and small houses, good schools, churches, stores, and even an ugly old section by the railroad tracks. And it had, everyone believed, the best police force in the world. For more than a year, no one, boy, girl, or grown-up, had got away with breaking a single law. Encyclopedia's father was chief of police. People said he was the smartest chief of police in the world, and his officers were the best trained and the bravest. Chief Brown knew better. His men were brave, true enough. They did their jobs well. But Chief Brown brought his hardest cases home for Encyclopedia to solve. For a year now, Chief Brown had been getting the answers during dinner in his red brick house on Rover Avenue. He never told a soul. How could he? Who would believe that the guiding hand behind Idaville's crime cleanup wore a junior-size baseball mitt? Encyclopedia never let out the secret, either. He didn't want to seem different from other fifth graders. There was nothing he could do about his nickname, however. An encyclopedia is a book or set of books filled with facts on all subjects. Encyclopedia had read so many books, his head held more facts than a library. Nobody but his teachers and parents called him by his real name, Leroy. He was called Encyclopedia by everyone else in Idaville. Encyclopedia did not do all his crime busting seated at the dinner table. During the summer, he usually solved mysteries while walking around. Soon after vacation began, he had opened his own detective business. He wanted to help others. Children seeking help of every kind came to his office in the Brown garage. Encyclopedia handled each case himself. The terms of his business were clearly stated on the sign that hung outside the garage. One morning, Speedy Flanagan, the shortest fastball pitcher in the Idaville Little League, walked into the Brown Detective Agency. He wore a face longer than the last day of school.
"I need help," he said, side-arming 25 cents onto the gasoline can beside Encyclopedia. "What do you know about browning?"
"Nothing. I've never browned," replied Encyclopedia. "But once at the beach, I tanned something awful, and..."
"I mean Robert Browning," said Speedy.
"The English poet?"
"No, no," said Speedy. "The American League pitcher, Robert Spike Browning."
Even Encyclopedia's Aunt Bessie knew of Spike Browning. He was the ace of the New York Yankees pitching staff.
"What do you want to know about him?" asked Encyclopedia.
"Do you know what his handwriting looks like?" asked Speedy. "I made a bet with Bugs Meany, my bat against his, that Bugs couldn't get Spike Browning to buy a secret pitch for $100.
"Whoa!" cried Encyclopedia. "If I understand you, Bugs bet he could sell Spike Browning a special way to throw a baseball?"
"Right. Bugs and his father were in New York City the last week in June," said Speedy. "Bugs says he sold Spike Browning his cross-eyed special."
"You'd better explain," said Encyclopedia.
"The pitcher crosses his eyes whenever there are runners on first and third bases," said Speedy. "That way nobody knows where he's looking, whether he's going to throw to first base, third base, or home plate. The runners don't dare take a lead. The secret is how the pitcher can throw the ball someplace while staring himself in the eye. Bugs sold the secret. He has a letter from Spike Browning and a check for $100.
"Phew," said Encyclopedia. "I understand you now. You figure Bugs wrote the letter and the check himself to win the bet and your bat.
So do I. Let's go see Bugs."
Bugs Meany was the leader of the Tigers, a gang of older boys who caused more trouble than itching powder in Friday's wash. Since setting up as a detective, Encyclopedia had stopped many of Bugs' shady deals. The Tigers' clubhouse was a tool shed behind Mr. Sweeney's auto body shop. When Encyclopedia and Speedy arrived, Bugs was leading a discussion on how to beat the bubblegum machines around town. The tiger's leader broke off to greet Encyclopedia.
Get lost, he said.
Not until I have a chance to see the letter and check from Spike Browning, said Encyclopedia.
Bugs opened a cigar box and passed Encyclopedia a check and a letter. Encyclopedia read the letter.
Yankee Stadium, New York, June 31st. Dear Bugs, your cross-eyed pitch is the greatest thing since the spitball. I expect to win 30 games with it this season. For sole rights to the secret of it, I'm happy to enclose my check for $100. Yours truly, Spike Browning. The letter was written on plain white paper. The check, bearing the same date as the letter, was drawn on the First National Bank for $100.
Spike will win 50 games this season, said Bugs, and I won one baseball bat from Speedy Flanagan. So where is it?
Where's your bat? Corrected Encyclopedia. Speedy won the bet. You lost. The letter and check are fakes.
I ought to shove those words down your throat, said Bugs, but I'm feeling too good about what I did for the great American game of baseball.
Bugs crossed his eyes. Humming to himself, he went into his secret throwing motion. The other tigers cheered wildly.
Man, oh man, sang Bugs. I invented the greatest pitch since Edison threw out the gas lamp. No smart aleck private detective is going to walk in here and call me a liar.
Oh yes, I am, said Encyclopedia. Spike Browning never wrote that letter. That check is a worthless piece of paper. What made Encyclopedia so certain?
Solution to the case of the secret pitch. Encyclopedia knew instantly that neither the letter nor the check was written by the Yankee pitcher Spike Browning, nor by any grown-up. Both the check and the letter bore the same date, June 31st, but no year was given. And there is no June 31st. June has only 30 days. Shown the errors, Bugs could do nothing but admit having written the letter and check himself. As the loser of the bet, he had to give Speedy Flanagan his baseball bat. The Case of the Balloon Man.
Leroy, Mrs. Brown called. Leroy, it's time for dinner. Wash up, please.
Encyclopedia put down the book he was reading, 6 Ways to Reach the Moon on a Budget. In the bathroom, he gave his face a lick and a promise. When he got to the table, his father looked at him in a strange way.
Do you know Bobby Tyler? Chief Brown asked his only child.
Sure, said Encyclopedia. He was in my homeroom last year. Did anything happen to him, Dad?
He's missing, said Chief Brown.
You mean he ran away from home?
Chief Brown shook his head.
Encyclopedia gasped. Mrs. Brown stopped in the kitchen doorway. Her eyes opened wide. Kidnapped? Mother and son asked together.
It looks that way, answered Chief Brown.
Do you know who took Bobby? Asked Mrs. Brown.
Yes, Izzy the Balloon Man.
Izzy? Cried Encyclopedia. No, Dad, Izzy couldn't do anything so terrible.
What do you know about Izzy? Asked Chief Brown gently. Do you know what kind of man he really is? Do you even know where he lives?
I know he loves children, insisted Encyclopedia. Otherwise he wouldn't do what he does for a living.
He has an old truck and sells ice cream, candy, and soda, mostly to children, Chief Brown explained to his wife.
Why is he called the Balloon Man? She asked. If you buy more than 70 cents worth of candy or anything, he gives you a green and pink balloon free, answered Encyclopedia.
I guess Izzy got tired of blowing up balloons, said Chief Brown quietly. Bobby's father is wealthy, so Izzy...
I don't believe it, exclaimed Encyclopedia. You ought to see Izzy stick the end of a balloon in his mouth and huff and puff like a steam engine till it's blown up. He always makes funny faces so the kids will laugh.
All right, son, said Chief Brown. I'll accept 3 facts. 1, Izzy is a funny fellow who always blows up balloons with his mouth for laughs. 2, children love him and he loves children. And 3, Sam Potts saw him kidnap little Bobby Tyler this afternoon.
There was an eyewitness? Encyclopedia asked.
Mr. Potts came down to headquarters when he heard little Bobby was missing. He gave me a complete statement.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.